forget you ever knew about it, heard about it. And I said, Bill, that's insane. I says, you mean I should just walk away when I know horrible, evil things are being done and some people in very high positions are involved, and I should just walk away? He says, yeah. He says, you better learn the same lesson I've had to learn in life. Sometimes there are forces too powerful and too evil for us to control or topple in the time frame or manner we want or think. And so sometimes the safest thing and most difficult thing is just to walk away. And I says, well, should I start carrying a gun then? Mm. And he laughed and he said, no. If anything, that'll just get you killed faster.
Yeah,
I says, well, what can I do to protect myself a little? He says, well, the single best thing you can do is simply tell everything you know. You know, just put it down in writing.
Right.
And whether anybody ever believes it, reads it, whatever, then there's no percentage in doing you in because you've already told everything you know, and they'll just give credibility to you if you. Anyway, so that's what I did. I wrote the book, and as I say, I never spent one dime advertising or promoting or anything. I just wrote it as kind of a self-defense measure, and it's caught on among a lot of people, and it's just amazing how many of the things I kind of wrote about and predicted in there in some ways, or said this is what really happened. For example, things on the Oklahoma bombing and some of the other things.
Right.
Now I see in the big, 10th century anniversary, God, they're saying exactly, even the legitimate press, as they call it, saying some of the same things, you know. Why did that building get taken down so quick? You remember I had that part in the book where I was representing the people and I had all the arrangements made to actually keep the building standing so it could be examined.
Yep.
And then the attorney for Mr. McVeigh calls me on the phone and begs me to let him file the motion to keep the building standing and let him file that because he, as the head of, the attorney for the criminal defendant, has an absolute right to keep evidence in existence. And so he wanted me also to turn over to him at that time the firm I had retained that was going to do the investigation. That was the Joseph
Kennedy.
Kennedy and Associates or something.
Right.
They were supposedly the world's best investigators of bomb stuff and that kind of junk. And so I agreed because I was representing individuals, you know, grand jurors, and that's completely different than representing somebody on the criminal case.
Yeah.
So he would have an absolute guaranteed right to keep the building standing. So I immediately agreed to let him take over my motions and agreed to let him take over, even the Kennedy and Associates. And I thought, wow, now we've got a 100% winner because they'll keep the building standing and nobody can stop him because he's the number one criminal defendant in the whole thing, and they have to preserve the evidence.
Right.
And it wasn't, 24 hours later, I'm watching CNN, and he has just agreed, this attorney that, you know, that represented McVeigh, he's just agreed to allow the building to be taken down immediately, and so on. So I called screaming and hollering at him, saying, what the, you know, blank, blank, blank is going on? And he said, well, we just decided that we couldn't afford that Kennedy and Associates. I said, hell, I'll raise the money for you. I'll raise the money.
Right.
And he said, well, we've made our decision. And, hell, it wasn't a couple hours later. That building was down.
It was down, right.
And so I wrote about one chapter in the book about my representation of the people there and the grand juror.
He only wanted $30,000 down, by the way.
That's right. He wanted $30,000.
That's all. That's nothing.
And I told him I'd raise that in a heartbeat.
Yep.
Well, he said, we made our mind. We've reached agreement with the government. The building's coming down almost immediately. And sure enough, it did. So I still have wonder questions about
Mr. Stephen Jones.
Yeah, who was doing what and who was representing who and so on and so forth. But that's neither here nor there. That's not the story of this book. That's just one little piece at the end that I got involved in that case. But anyway, I better shut up and answer your question.
No, John, I love it because you make it easy for me. But John,
where do you live?
I live in just outside of Santa Fe, New Mexico.
Well, you're way down south.
Yeah, where it's muddy and cold.
Well, that's God's country down there.
Yeah, but he's been on vacation. He hasn't been around here until...
I love New Mexico. I had an assignment there for 5 years.
Oh, that's right. Albuquerque, right?
Oh, yeah. I was there for 5 years as a street agent.
Yep, yep. I remember hearing about that. I think they're still talking about it.
Well, I wouldn't be surprised. Yeah. They're talking about me other places, too.
That's true. John.
But anyway, John is a hero, Alex, and the people listening to this show. Instead of being a bomb, like I was told he was, he ended up being a hero. He's one of my heroes, and this man is, he's great. He's a great American.
I think
and
so,
And I remember I had dinner with John here not too long ago, and his oldest daughter was giving him a hard time, and I said, wait a minute. Your daddy is a hero. Now, you better respect him for that. You remember that, John?
No, but that's okay. My daughter just had a grandchild, my first grandchild.
By your oldest daughter?
Yeah, Jenny.
Jenny? Oh, that's great. Well, tell her congratulations.
Yeah, congratulations. But why are you taking so long?
That's true, because like my kids say, my youngest boy is Johnny. He's 16.
Hmm.
And he's discovered that... all the other fathers are about 20 years younger, and the grandfathers are about my age, so he's kind of suspicious what's going on.
That's neat. Hey, John, tell us, if you would, please, how you first got involved with the Johnny Gosch case.
Oh, the Johnny Gosch? Well, that was deep into the Franklin case already.
Oh.
I first got involved.
Well, why don't we start out with the Franklin case?
Let's back up and hit the Franklin case then, yeah.
Well, I was representing a couple senators. I had gotten out of the Senate by that time, and I was just practicing law. I had discovered something that is more profitable than honest work. It's called ambulance chasing, representing personal injury cases. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Automobile accidents.
Right.
It's almost better than stealing. But anyway, most lawyers won't tell
you. At least
that.
You're honest.
But anyway, so I still have a division of people working for me doing that. Chasing them ambulance. No, forget this. You never heard that. But anyway, so one day, this credit union got robbed.
Mm-hmm.
Or more correctly, it didn't get robbed. They had the federal officials, FBI and IRS, did a raid on the place the day after the 1988 election. The day after the 88 election, November election, and raided it and seized all the records. And for whatever reason, they discovered there was $40 million missing out of this little dinky credit union in North Omaha, run by a pretty big man named Larry King. Larry King was on the front page of various magazines and even the New York Times, as I recall, and officially labeled as the fastest rising black star in the Republican Party.
That's not Larry King live now.
No.
No, this is another Larry King. And the fact is, Larry King is back in Washington now after put him away for about 9 or 10 years, but now he's released on parole, and guess where he went? Right back to Washington, D.C. Got himself paroled there. Larry King was arrested, and of course then strange stories started filtering out from young people, 13, 14, 15, 18, 17-year-old kids, boys mostly, and some girls, about how, they knew Larry King. They flew on his private jet to New York or to Washington or whatever, and they were with this or that politician, and the stories got a little more sickening in that they started talking about how they were involved in sex relations with this or that politician or this or that very, very powerful, prominent businessman, and on and on.
Who were they telling this to, John?
Well, these were stories coming out on the streets.
Okay.
Wow.
And one kid or another, and I was one of the first ones after these were just getting really heavy duty, you know, and the state Senate was going to, I encouraged them to start looking into it just to clear it up, but one thing or another led to my being confronted as to what my thoughts and opinions were on it, and I said, well, I'll be honest with you, I think it's the most unbelievable nonsense I've ever heard in my life. And then I foolishly said something else. I said, if I really, ever, honestly believed any of this, I would be the first one